call me Vega Cascadian. This is Hector Molina, and we're here to talk about resurrecting computers with free software. I'm involved in a computer reuse and recycling organization in Portland, Oregon, in the United States. And Hector is involved in some projects in Venezuela. Anywhere there are computers, there are obsolete computers. So this means that there are computers sitting in closets, in basements, in places where they're just going to waste. There are a lot of people who don't have access to computers. On top of that, there are a lot of toxic compounds in computers. So sometimes, instead of leaving a computer sit in their closet for 10 years or something, people just toss it in a landfill, or even worse, it'll end up like getting shipped overseas, thrown on a big pile, and burned. This releases mercury, cadmium, all sorts of toxic heavy metals into the atmosphere or leaks into the water supply. Computers are extremely dangerous pieces of equipment. It's not just computers, all electronics, but computers are obsoleted so quickly that it's a pretty chronic problem. The organization I've worked with and volunteered with is called FreeGeek.org, and they essentially decide, well, we've got people who don't have computers, we have this big waste problem, let's push those two problems together and come up with something that helps everybody out. That FreeGeek does is they take in all the equipment that nobody no longer uses. They teach volunteers how to process it, catalog it, and then rebuild the computers. So this, we're training people some computer skills, while at the same time we're getting computers back to volunteers. There's two main programs. And then the other side benefit is we're using volunteers to break the equipment down into smaller parts. So we break out all the plastics into one bin, all the steel into another, the stuff that's really heavy on copper. A bucket of processors can range anywhere in between $300 and $800 in US currency, depending on various market because of the gold content in them. So all of these raw materials actually have value. The organization can run, it meets a significant portion of its revenue just from the waste products. Let's see here. And because FreeGeek is doing all this stuff, we want to document it all. So there's wiki.freegeek.org that documents everything, as much as we can get around to documenting about the organization. And ideally, we'd have everything on there. You could just go there and create your own FreeGeek wherever you go. We have a specific page geared towards startup organizations, and that is the FreeGeek Startups page. So there are several organizations in the U.S. that have taken what FreeGeek has done and started their own operations in other places. Most of them don't process nearly the same volume that FreeGeek in Portland's doing, but we're getting started and you have to start somewhere. That's pretty much the basic gist of it. FreeGeek.org.
I just want to point out that when I was laid off at Boeing in 2001, I was a Solaris system administrator. Solaris was kind of going by the wayside, and even I knew that Linux was picking up. I had not had much Linux experience, so I spent my 2 years of unemployment volunteering at FreeGeek, starting in May of 2002, and 2.5 years later, I was able to put down what I've done at FreeGeek on my resume. This is all volunteer work. And that is what got me the job I'm currently holding at Intel. If it weren't for FreeGeek and the educational volunteer opportunity there, I would not be at Intel, and most likely I would not be at this conference right now. So I can say that the educational experience that one gets there is quite invaluable.
Yes.
So another thing, we have all this free software, right? Well, what good is free software if you don't have a computer, right? So the whole process of FreeGeek enables a lot more people to gain access to the internet, to gain experience developing free software. We have a coding program where it's pretty loosely defined, but we try and teach people how to code, learn skills. We have volunteer system administrators running the organization. And we give out computers to something like 15, I think on average, like 10 to 15 people a week, some of whom this is their first computer. Running a slightly modified Debian install, using at the moment KDE. There's a lot of talk about moving to Ubuntu, if you'd like to pick up on what's going on in Venezuela.
Sorry for my English, it's very bad. We are talking about the personal experience with our computers and free software. We are working with free software and our computers for almost 4 years. I write a piece about it. We have a situation in our country because we have many school with limited budget for buying computers. In my country, we have a school system very wide in all the country, but we have many schools with almost 10 pupils. Yes, with almost 10 pupils. 20 pupils is all the school, but all the budgets in that school is for pay the teachers, is not for another field. Okay, and we have a presidential degree for using free software in all public administration. That is a very revolutionary. And in this moment, in Venezuela, we have a decree for use only free software in all administration. In this moment, it's only in the central administration, but more later will be in all administration. That is very important, and we have in this moment many projects using free software, okay? And we have many persons working in free software. I have about the number, and later I will. Okay, almost we have one biggest petroleum estate company in the world. Okay, and they buy modern computers every year. I don't understand that. Okay, I don't understand. But every year, the company says we need new computers, take the computers, keep the computers in small in big room, put new computer in all desktop. It's a crazy, but it's the reality. Well, they have many using computers, which are very useful for our colleagues. In my city, we asked to PDVSA, that is a company, if we can get our computers, and PDVSA say don't worry. And PDVSA say, take a truck, load a few computers, and put it in my CD. All that computer, they are working in small school, in public access library, in public internet access hall. Okay? We are working in projects to get touch computers in public access libraries, in the public access point, lab in schools, and others. And I have a video produced by the government of Venezuela. And this video, they show libraries and schools, and those schools and those libraries, we have projects like LTSP, working with old computers and working with all free software. Maybe more later I put in Homer in the section share for you can see. Now, where we recycle computers in Venezuela? We have many old and user computers. Many schools don't have computers. The non-free software is not disabled with all the computers. When you can buy computers, you have three computers, and in 1 year, maybe 2 years, the non-free software save you. You need a new license. You need pay me for still using the software. That is a bad idea. And that all computers don't can use the software. The free software is the right choice for use all computers. Okay? The free software works in all the computers which give many options for use. In this moment, we have computer like the 4HC and 5HC and Pentium 1 and Pentium 2 working in school, working in library, working in public internet access point. We have a concept named public internet access point. It's a room with all computers, with a server like Pentium 3, Pentium 4, and all the people can to come at the room and the center, and they can browse internet and work with many software, and they don't pay anything. Okay, it's a free use. Some solutions for the situations. We have in Venezuela full LTSP project implementation. We are working with LTSP project for almost 3-4 years. And we have a third party in February 2006 in Caracas, sponsored by SAPI. It's controversial because SAPI is a patent office. And SAPI is a very close with the free software movement. Okay, maybe Jose, my friend, can explain the situation more detailed. My English is very poor. Okay, and in this event, they have a cluster with all 4HC computers, almost 40. Okay, in this part. Jose, can you speak?
Yeah, SAPI is the Venezuelan Patents Office. Since 2004, we have been using free software, specifically Debian. We have hosted the first Debian mirror in our country. And in 2006, we got together with the trolls. They self-named them as trolls. They are from France and Germany. They are Debian users, and they came to our country to make this resurrection project. We have 486 computers, Vectras, HP Vectras, I think, and they made all the arrangements that so we can use them with LTSP and all that stuff. And we also made an installation festival that day. And SAPI is the only patents office in Latin America that doesn't patent software, neither software nor light. We don't patent light beams. So it's very controversial. We are actually in the blacklist of Microsoft.
We are working in customized .dev package for MTSP project. That package contains carrier modifications, the new software for the desktop, and all that. Okay. We have some government institutions like America implementing the solution for schools and community internet access. In the city of Mérida, in this moment, we are working with cooperativas.
Cooperatives.
It's an institution. I work in the city, and we are working with cooperative movement in our city for get full implementation of LTSP project. And full implementation is for the community, okay? The full implementation is put in our mirror, and we have many set of rules, and the people come in our room, and they can go, and they can use the CDU free, okay? We are working in Spanish documentation. We are working in Spanish documentation because many people in our city don't have to speak Spanish language. Okay? And we are working in Spanish tutorial too. And I have a number about the free software modeling in Venezuela. We have almost three big discussion leads with almost 2,500 persons. We are working on we have the Debian Day all the years. We have government decree, and the community in this moment is working very close with the government for make a new decree. Okay? We have a solar application for our country. We have the sponsored by two big companies. The number one is PDVSA. PDVSA produced almost 2 million of barrel of petroleum all day. PDVSA is very close in this moment with the Venezuelan Free Software Modeling. PDVSA sponsored many projects. For example, PDVSA paid me the flight ticket for going to the home. PDVSA, you two? Okay, two persons. PDVSA is sponsored many projects. And another company is the CBG. CBG is a steel company. And the CBG is very big. And PDVSA have a project based in free software. That is very important for the free software community in Venezuela. Sponsors cheap by two big companies, and is inconditional. ¿Cómo se dice?
Unconditional.
Inconditional. It's inconditional sponsor for the free software world. If we need, for example, they say the free software world, we need a new internet access. okay, what do you need? Do you need 1 megabit, 2 megabit, 3 megabit, 4 megabit? What do you need? And you need a new computer? Okay, don't worry. The computer is in the office. You can use. Don't worry. Yeah, but it's all my talk. Excuse me, my cool needs.
Do folks have some questions to ask about anything, or anything you'd like us to elaborate on? Yes.
How does Debian's Tonal work for you with all the hardware?
I've just recently started playing with Sarge Debian installer using preseeding and stuff like that. But we do have some customized scripts that just basically map over NFS and rsync the whole file system. But we do, I've made some installer CDs that install the distribution we use. And it's called, I wrote some wrapper scripts around Debian installer called Simple CDD, or wrappers around Debian CD more, but which basically just takes the Debian, or it downloads all the files off of a Debian mirror, builds a CDD with some pre-seeding. And we've also started experimenting with network-based pre-seeding and stuff, but it's a lot slower to actually install the packages than it is to just rsync onto a file system. Yeah, and some of these computers, they're getting to be decently fast now. I think the computers are like 700 to 866 megahertz that we're giving away. And then we're giving away like 900 megahertz to like 1.2 gigahertz to a few nonprofits, but that's more like 10 to 20 a month. But yeah, it floors me how fast our spec has gone up. When I started working there in 2003, we were still using P1 like 166s.
I remember that.
So just in a couple of years, skyrocketed. But yeah, have you used
Debian installer? Yeah, we are working in Debian installer. I try to work in the Debian installer for the Debian day, but I have error and long and good, because in Venezuela, one project is DIMUT, is a cooperative institution. We have a Debian installer, okay, with only menus in Spanish, with only documentation in Spanish. And with link for another project like that.
Okay, I think we're very interested to have some kind of link to your CCB stuff and your Debian installer wiki pages.
Excellent.
So if you would like to add that, you're welcome.
Question I have for people is, do you know of organizations in your local area, or are you interested in starting one at all? Anybody? Heard of anything?
I've been attempting to do it repeatedly in the UK. There are some depressing things that go on. Because funding is available, it's easy for schools to get funding for computers. So they don't have the pressure to put the effort into looking at whether it's going to work with Linux instead. And the other thing I found out recently is that if you have a site license as a school in the UK for Microsoft Windows and the Office suite, it's about £100 per seat.
That's irregardless of that.
And that's regardless of whether you're actually running on. That's for any machine that's more than Pentium 100 class. Regardless of whether it's got a single byte of Windows on it, you pay $100 per seat. So I go to school, sorry, £100 per seat.
Wow.
So I go to school, 40 computers that I'm coming from a an international bank that I do work for. And it's going to cost them about, I've worked it out, I've forgotten the number, and this sounds too big, but I think it might be right. £35, no, that's probably £3.50 a year, just because I get into some reviews.
That is fucked up.
And the great point is that you have to get the schools to the point where they have off their computers and other books before it becomes cheaper to buy the software and usually the other half of the programs.
So they just have a contract that we pay this much for every seat?
Yeah, and they're kind of building the computers, like, we've got this nice computers.
I know in the US, Microsoft tried to, like, mandatorily enforce that on schools, and the schools just revolted. I mean, just like,
well, this is kind of the volunteer program.
Right.
But once they...
One volunteer program.
No, it was a saving for them. You know, half their costs. So, which means that in order to break even, you have to have at least half the number of Windows running computers in the school. That means that they have no real incentive to do it.
Right.
So, and it is a problem. I have got some, there is a project that's being put together by Unity and some other people where there's a bit of DTI, the Department of Training Industry, and some EU funding, which, with a bit of luck, we may be able to do it as a seal search project and have it as a test case to show that you can actually save money by doing it. But you need inventive people, and a lot of people in the schools either haven't got time or the energy to be inventive. So they just get on with doing what they're doing.
How did you get support from your patent office? That sounds like a good trick.
The work is the forum, is the forum. And the public institution have a form, and they pay a cooperative institution. Okay? We have in Venezuela, the government have another decree for make a cooperative institution, and we have many cooperative institutions, and the government when must have make a contract prefer a cooperative institution. I think this is the decree. So the public institution pay the cooperative for make the project and make the support in paying our service. It's the experience, the situation. And it worked. It worked and all the people is win, because it's not only one, it's not a big company, the only win. If only a small company, like a cooperative institution, the win. It's amazing because the big cooperative institution, the owner, our students, our young people, student and young people is the right way for our country, because always all the people means in the culture.
No more questions? Come on. As you see, there's a number of excellent.
How about non-x86 hardware? Have you played with that at all, or just it's not worth? It's too much effort to support it.
We have a sister project, just a couple hours south from us, called, they used to be called Mac Renewal, but now they're called Lane County CCRC or something. It's right there up at the top. And they basically handle all of our Mac-related equipment. We get some Spark stuff in, we've gotten some Alpha stuff. I've kind of played around with making that work as diskless terminals. We get some really oddball stuff. We've started setting up like a computer museum. We just got one of the TRS-80.
Yes.
We just got one of those in not so long ago. We had a Zeos machine a while back, and it was all like in a wooden case. Crazy. So we get some really oddball hardware. Also to keep the organization running, but we don't really make use of most of the oddball hardware. We typically will like put it up for sale on eBay to help with organizational costs, or we have a thrift store that people come in and just buy used equipment. So we do what we can, but it's almost the vast majority is x86 related hardware.
You want to mention the collab?
I
can put a little bit. I can do a little bit of that.
Sure.
Okay. At one time, we had a grant from the Meyer Memorial Trust to take a nonprofit currently running commercial software and essentially convert it to running all open source software. The nonprofit that we worked with was a mental health agency, and they were using some fairly old commercial software for their patient tracking system. And it would have been quite expensive to get it upgraded to current standards. And they would have to upgrade the Windows, and they would have to upgrade their hardware. So what we did, we looked at replacing all their Windows desktops with Linux, using, and I can't remember anything, they were using LTSP. But the big part of the project was to take the patient tracking system and try to replace it with something that's open source. And we found that there was a hospital in New York, St. Vincent's Hospital in New York, had been working on an open source patient tracking system. SQL Clinic was the name of it, running off of a Postgres backend database. And we took that, but they published it open source, and we worked with them. Their people were willing to work with us to adapt that piece of software to work on our situation, because we're not a full in-bed hospital. We were a outpatient mental health clinic, and some of the requirements are different, but structurally, the basic concept is the same. And unfortunately, it took a lot more than we anticipated to do the change, because the scoping of the project was quite challenging, but we were able to do it. We did make changes in that software, and we in turn published it to make it available to others, so other health agencies can use it. But essentially, we were able to take them off of the Windows environment, except one or two machines that they had to have because they were agencies they dealt with that required using Windows to deal with them. And unfortunately, one of them is the Oregon Department of Revenue. But there's a piece of software that you're required to use to file their returns. I don't know much about it, and that requires Windows. Beyond that, they were able to wean much of the agency off of Windows. And using free computers that we got, they were able to augment their install base, I think, if I'm not mistaken, without having to buy a single new computer. Even though the project went over budget and over time, there was a lot of lessons learned, and it could be repeated now that we know what to expect, know what we're going to get into. And the concept could be valid. You could take somebody somebody's Windows infrastructure and replace it with open source.
He had mentioned some software that we've worked on. We have a few pieces of software that we use to run FreeGeek. FGDB is a PHP web interface to keep track of all the devices we get. It's also a contact management system. So anybody who comes in to volunteer or to donate stuff will typically try, you know, track information on them and use it for good, not evil. FGDiag is some hardware testing scripts written in Python. FGDB basically was like, it came out of a class we taught on this is how to learn Python, or how to write Python. FGDB came out of how to write PHP. There was a class on Python which resulted in the FGDiag, which is a hardware diagnostics. And then somebody wrote FG scheduling for like managing our staff scheduling. I have no idea what it's written in, but those are some of the highlights. We also, back in the day, I wrote a system called Lestis, which made it into Sarge, but hopefully won't make it into Etch. And it was basically a Discus terminal implementation that was very Debian-based. It used a bootstrap to install the environment rather than building a bunch of binaries. And we're currently working on moving towards an LTSP bootcamp project, which does a very similar thing. And so that way, you're not reusing all the binaries or re-implementing all of the binaries. We're just reusing standard Debian binaries for the Discus terminals implementation. Yes, question?
Well, just sending you a question that's here in the IRC from Maxi. He says that he really prefers to set up thin clients, because basically any machine can be set as an X server, and you need one more powerful server in the network. So you can have a very small netroot image and it starts an X server, and for many situations that's enough.
Yes, I started the Lestis project one day when we had a classroom full of machines that were basically just logging into a server, and the hard drive failed on it. And I'm like, this is ridiculous. All these machines are doing is logging into a server, so we should use Discus terminals. And it's a really good way to make use of older hardware. Even a 486 can be used as a Discus terminal, though FreeGeek actually doesn't keep anything below a P3500, much to my surprise. Discus terminals are amazing. That's probably one of my main projects, is working on Discus terminals. We kind of use them for everything. We use them to run the hardware testing software. We use them to install our machines. We use them as public access terminals. We love Discus.
Questions?
So I want you all to go and start up FreeGeeks at your home, or call it whatever you want. But I know you all use computers, and so probably there are unused computers within miles of where you live, or kilometers, or whatever you like to measure it by. That's your homework assignment. So, any questions about your homework assignment? No questions. You all know how to do this kind of a thing.
Oh, we have the wiki, don't we?
It's true, you do have the wiki. Good idea. Okay. I was hoping to hear more about other projects, because I know they're out there.
I have one question. You mentioned in the beginning that you sell buckets of scrap material.
Yes.
So which part of the machines you get in do you scrap, and which part do you recycle?
We recycle everything. basically. The most difficult thing to deal with is monitors. They contain between 3 and 8 pounds of lead.
Oh, sorry, I meant scrap recycle versus reuse.
Right. We try, I think our current statistics are for every 5 computers, we put 1 back into reuse.
Okay.
That's about the average statistic. Yeah, a huge part of that is simply warehouse space.
Okay, alright, you're right.
There are definitely, like I said earlier, we're anything below a P3 500, we're just outright recycling, because if we didn't do that, we'd end up later down the road recycling like an 800 or a 900 megahertz system because we ran out of space spending all this time on this older equipment. But I'm very interested in setting up projects to work with other organizations to ship some of our lower end stuff to places, you know. We've done a few projects like that, which with very, very mixed results. One that was really successful was sending equipment to Uganda, although when we got there we found that they had a lab of like P4s sitting in boxes unused. So we sent them a bunch of P2s and P3s and were very surprised. And so there it was more of a cultural, like teaching people how to fix problems. But we've also had a few projects to send equipment to Central and South America, which have had very mixed results on. One time we actually got a bunch of equipment confiscated at the Mexico border. Yeah, that was a bummer. But we're learning how to do more international grants better, slowly learning. But a big part of it is there are computers almost everywhere, so it might be better to send people there to teach locals who are interested in setting up computer recycling organizations, and to kind of seed the projects along with a little bit of know-how or experience. We got
15
minutes.
How do you come up with the people that you actually inflict these computers on?
Because
I have come across many computers, but I don't have that many people that are going, yes, I want to load computers to do something that's not Windows on computers.
Most of it started out as word of mouth.
Right.
There was, before the organization even really existed, it started out at a tabling at an Earth Day event in Portland, Oregon, where it's like, I have this idea, I have a name, you know, it's called Free Geek, we're going to take computers and give them away to people, right? Basically, since then, sometime later that year, that was in 2000, somebody put an ad in the local paper that said free computers and the phone number. And then they were flooded from there on. So it's kind of gotten crazier every consecutive day since. But never really had to put much energy into advertising. It's mostly been word of mouth. They've gotten some media coverage, usually local. There's been some even international coverage, I believe.
Did you have a warehouse?
Oso Martin is the founder, and it started with just a bunch of computers sitting around his house, and then people were like, oh, you're collecting computers, so they gave him more and more as they piled up.
That's my house, the one.
Right. I've heard a number of people.
I have a load of programs and stack on the tables in my living room.
So. It's kind of a gravity thing. Once you get a certain amount of old unused computers together, more will just gravitate towards them. People will hear that, oh, you're collecting computers, they'll come. I think you had a question.
Do you have trouble with either more people wanting computers than you have but ready to give out, or do you have the opposite problem, more computers or it's just bounces up and down?
It varies some. Right now, the most coordinated program, there's two main programs at FreeGeek. One is you spend 24 hours volunteering with the organization and you get a computer, where people will do anything from like actually busting up the computers into the plastics and the metals and ripping them to pieces, and then the other people who actually will evaluate the systems, and we teach them how to identify based on physical characteristics or booting them up, what general class of computers are, and then they go on to actually rebuild the computers. And that program is basically like a build six, you get to keep the six, although only about a third of the people in the computer building program actually even want the computer. Most of them are just in it for the experience.
Yeah, that was my case, and I built way more than six.
Yeah.
I built close to six.
We've got people who have we have like these sheets of paper where you write down how many they built, and it just goes on and on and on. It's like a couple. There's some people who probably built hundreds of computers.
Oh yeah, easily.
So right now the build program is the most elaborate program that we can teach people, and then they can replicate that over and over again. They'll encounter different problems and issues, but it's a pretty replicable thing to teach. The coding program has been a little different in that sense. You can teach somebody how to code, but you can't just tell them repeat that same code over and over again. It's not very useful. So teaching somebody how to program is a lot harder than teaching somebody how to build a computer.
What do you do with data left on hard disks for computers that get sent in?
We wrote as part of the FreeGeek diagnosis test. We have something that runs bad blocks several times over the drives. We've been exploring some other techniques, but we do make sure to at least four wipes, I think, is our standard.
Yeah.
Which gets it to the point where they would really have to invest ridiculous amounts of money in order to get it. Any drives that we recycle, we actually physically destroy.
So you don't do any data recycling as part of the...
No. The legal liability is just too dangerous for the organization.
In which space do you disassemble and then assemble the PCs?
Could you repeat that?
Where do you disassemble and assemble the PCs?
Where?
Yes.
There's a community center. Maybe I will point to the webpage. It's a community center, and we don't just do computer things. I forget exactly how big the floor space is.
It's 15,000. Each section is 5,000. We started with one 5,000 square foot building, and then we expanded out to 15,000 square feet, and we are bursting at the seams right now.
Right. So we have a lot of space. Some of it's dedicated. There's like a meeting room. There's kind of like a community events room. If you see at the webpage, there's a bike swap meet at FreeGeek. So we do things. We've started actually hosting like art showings at the space. So it's more than just like computers too. We try and draw in a broader pool of the community, so that FreeGeek is just part of the community. It's not just a bunch of geeks playing with computers, which I think is absolutely essential. I like to focus on the free part of FreeGeek. Some people more interested in the geek part.
But we had a prom last Saturday night. We had a formal prom.
Yeah.
You know, this is prom season, so we had geek prom. Okay, if you're going to be in Portland in the summertime, I think it's right, we have an event called Geek Fair. We have a block party. We actually closed the block, and a lot of very interesting events. One of them is for those of you who are very, very frustrated at printers. Now, there cannot be any one of you in here who have never been frustrated with a printer. So, we've invented and patented this wonderful process, and that's called printer smashing. You pay, I think, $1 or something like that for the privilege of taking a sledgehammer and smashing a printer.
Or your weapon of choice.
What?
Or your weapon of choice.
Oh, your weapon of choice, and smashing a printer as much as your little heart desires. Those wonderful events like that. Now, last week, didn't they have a bicycle, something that they can ride their bikes into old computers or something like that, or some weird thing? So, yes, very wonderful. If you're in Portland area in the summertime, look us up.
Yes.
Yeah. How do they do in other countries where there is no community center?
That has been, I think that's the key to why Free Geek Portland was so successful when it started out, is they actually had startup funds for somebody to be there, like to rent a space for like 3 months and have somebody there staffing it for like, I think 5 days out of the week. And that was pretty key, I think. Having a space there where people know, oh, these people are open like 5-6 days a week, I can just drop in during these hours. You know, you'll never get them, the hours are like 11 to 7, so a lot of times people are like, what? These are crazy hours. But, but you know, having consistency with your hours and a space for people to just come and know they can drop in and help out or drop off their stuff or whatever, I think has been key. Some of the other Free Geeks that have started up in other areas in the U.S. have not had that privilege, and it's really slowed down the process. So I would recommend to anybody interested in starting one up to get a little more startup funds so you can have like even just a couple months of opening, operating expenses covered, which definitely increases the bar, but since they are so toxic, you should be getting into this without. You shouldn't be getting into this unless you're serious too. So I want to encourage people, but at the same time, like once you start taking computers and people know about it, the organizations that I've heard about it, they tend to get flooded like very quickly. So
you want to mention
my printer smashing photos.
You want to mention what were the startup costs? Remember how much it cost us to do that for 3 months?
Something like 30,000 to 40,000, maybe 50,000.
Okay.
I don't remember exactly.
For the rent and whole thing.
But, I don't know, smash type.
There it is. In the lower left. What? Isn't that smashing right there?
No, that's me dancing.
What's your dance?
That was enough.
So it's not completely self-funded?
Is it? I think it is now. We're just barely getting into the point that with the income from the recycling and the thrift store and what little bit we do on eBay, I believe, is finally becoming self-sustaining. We've had to, we've had to kind of refine our recycling, because the more you sort the raw materials, the more you get per pound for those raw materials. And I think in the beginning, perhaps our sorting was not quite as refined, but now we've got it to the point that we have what's called advanced recycling, where we can take the actual chips, break them off the boards, and put them in the pail by themselves. And we take the gold contacts, snap them off the board, put them in the pail. You have a 5 gallon bucket of gold contacts. That brings us, $500 or $600 for that bucket. If they were still on the boards, we would get nowhere near that kind of money. So the more we sort, the more we get. As far as I know, last I talked to someone there, we are starting to get break even and self-sustain. Maybe you know more about that, but that's what they told me a few weeks ago.
Free Geek has been steadily, the Collaborative Technologies Project did end up sinking Free Geek into debt, but after 1 year they've already recovered and are making more money back. They're definitely hoping to raise the standards for the staff again and stuff. They took a voluntary cut during the time. There's three main revenue streams, I believe. There's just people donating stuff when they bring in their things, which we have a mandatory fee for monitors because they're so hard to recycle. There's grants is another main donation or income source, though less and less reliant on that. Because FreeGeek has a physical income stream, it can do things like the thrift store, which generates a little revenue to support the organization. And then there's just the physical raw materials recycling, which FreeGeek is sending out several tons of raw materials every week, I believe.
Yeah.
It's crazy. But unlike a lot of nonprofit organizations, FreeGeek has a natural income of just physical equipment that allows them to be more financially self-sufficient.
Well, another thing that you need to point out is that our entire infrastructure, that means the computers that are used, all the stuff on the secretary's desk, the fax, the copying, everything that came into that place came in as part of the waste stream. So essentially, we're an extremely fortunate nonprofit to run on just about a zero capital budget. When I was told that the only capital infrastructure we bought, and correct me if I'm wrong, was a four-point hub a long time ago. That's it. Everything else came in through receiving. And we pay the rent, we pay for consumables like light bulbs and stuff like that, and we pay our salaries, but that's pretty much it. The infrastructure is, you know, right on the ground, it's zero budget.
Yeah.
Zero capital. There's no cost at all to the equipment that we use. The networking, the whole mess is free.
I think we're basically wrapping up. I hope you remember your homework assignment, and you'll be ready to start FreeGeek in your local area.
Thank you.